Karlsson, Karlsson, världens bästa Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, hoj här kommer Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, ingen faktiskt, ingen annan Karlsson spelar jag så bra som mig.
Karlsson, Karlsson, Karlsson scores!
Carlson.
Yay! Yes! Welcome everybody to another episode of the Keeping Carlson Fantasy Hockey Podcast, the longest running fantasy hockey podcast in the world, hosted by two guys, who one of whom is not here, but instead we've got an awesome ringer. My name is Elon Dubrovsky. I'm your host today, and with me is not Brian Com, but instead, you know him, or I'll tell you, I know him from the TSN Hockey Analytics podcast back in the day, the Locked On podcast, having the best freaking projections in the world. But most recently, you can find his work at the Sportsbook Review and with McKee Hockey. It's the great Scott Cullen. Welcome back to the Keeping Carlson, Scott.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Yeah, I'm super excited to be able to talk to you. I've got a bunch of players that I want to bring up that we've even talked about on recent episodes, but now that I had you here, I was like, okay, but now let's get Scott's take and find out what you think. Maybe just some general chat before we get into all of the news. Like, the main thing that I think most people know you for is you drop your projections, like, you know, 3 weeks or so before the season, and then every year at the end, and whenever anyone's ranking projections, you're right amongst the top of, like, having gotten things correctly. Like, what's your secret? Like, I know this is, like, a really, like, big answer, and it's like I'm asking you, it's just a quick intro, but like I'd love to just know a little bit about like what's your process of like how do you come up with how you're gonna predict like how many points a player is gonna get.
All right, well I guess the basic is for guys who are been in the league for a while, I just run a weighted average of the past three seasons, you know.
That's
the most recent season. Like for the guys who've been in the league now, that's not the whole thing, but that's sort of the baseline to get you started. And then, you know, I will look at percentages, you know, whether they've had inflated percentages along the way. Like if somebody's coming off a season where their on ice shooting percentage was 12.5%, I mean, wow, they're probably not going to do that again. And so then I start to adjust things down or up depending on where those were. And I mean, one of the things that I sort of have trouble with, I guess, is when you do those forecasts and you make your line combinations at the start of the year, and you're like, oh, well, this guy's going to play with these superstars. I should be really excited about this. And then like a week into the season, they change the lines. And all of a sudden that player that you thought was all set because they're playing with a superstar, it doesn't work. And so, I mean, yes, you have to be aware of the context and consider those opportunities. But I think as time has gone on, I've started to diminish how much value I place on that. It's not no value, but it's probably less value than it might have been 5 or 10 years ago when I was doing it, when I would get all excited about somebody getting this opportunity on the top line. And it's like, oh, every time the coach makes that change and takes them off the top line, you kind of die a little bit inside. And so I found that, you know, being able to, I guess you end up sticking closer to the historical numbers is what works in your favor. And now I guess there are still other, you know, lots of other players who haven't got a 3+ year track record in the league. And so I'll look to NHL equivalency for guys who are coming out of the AHL or junior hockey or Europe. I mean, that's a lot of players. And also look at, you know, if you're looking at, you know, a guy who has maybe been in the league for a couple of years, but if their opportunity is going to be significantly greater, like, you know, if they've been playing 12 minutes a game, but you look at their depth chart and it looks like, well, they're going to be playing 16 minutes a game this year for whatever reason, you have to kind of take all that into account. You know, context matters. And so that's one of the things is that, you know, I can go through my spreadsheets and have kind of a baseline, but I go through every player after I do that to kind of be like, okay, should we just continue kind of along the same path? Or is there a reason to believe that it's going up or down in addition? And so that ends up being the process, and it doesn't sound like, you know, it's not rocket science that I'm doing here, but in the end, we've tended to come up with some pretty accurate projections.
Yeah, it's interesting because it's almost like I feel like it's like asking, you know, like a singer, how do you sing well? Because on one hand, you're saying it's pretty straightforward. Like I make a spreadsheet, weighted average. But clearly the secret sauce is you kind of then looking at the projection and being like, do I think that the opportunity is like something for real that I should weigh? And how much should I weigh it? And maybe that's just something that all your experience.
Well, yeah. And I'm sure that's some of it, right? Is that, you know, I've been doing this for a long time. So some of this stuff you know, as I always say about it, it's you're mixing a little bit of art in with the science, you know, mm-hmm. the science, I guess, is using the weighted historical averages. And then the art is kind of putting the finishing touches on top of that.
All right. Well, I'm going to definitely be wanting to make use of whatever art you have in there to try to predict what's going to go on for the rest of the season here. And I've got a slew of players to talk about. I've got some headlines, injuries, outjuries, hot streaks, cold streaks. So we'll get through as much as we can. And I want to start with our top fantasy headline of the week, which is, of course, over in Edmonton. And actually a good example of what you're talking about in terms of there was a player that people were super excited about going into the year because of the opportunity. And now it's going away in Zach Hyman, right? Because everyone thought, hey, line one, power play one, Hyman, that's going to be gold. Like with McDavid, like what the sky's limit, 70 points, yeah, 80 points. Yeah. Now, all of a sudden, the Oilers have signed Evander Kane. So he's in. It's been one game so far. The Oilers drubbed the Habs 7-2. I don't know how much weight you want to put on a game where they were against the Habs.
Against the Habs, yeah.
But it went well. Like, I mean, Kane's slotted in on the top line with McDavid and Yamamoto. He scored an early goal on a deflection of a Bouchard shot, ended the game with a goal, three shots, four hits, over 17 minutes of ice time. Then as far as the power play went, it looks like they only had one power play in the game. Kane was on the second power play, though I've seen in practices they've tried him, so I wonder if maybe they'll change that. But it was Puljujärvi on the top power play, not Zach Hyman. Zach Hyman was way down on, I guess, the third line with Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, so definitely not the spot that people were expecting. But I guess let's start with Evander Kane first, because right now the Kane hype train is like at its peak, right? Everyone is pushing people over to try to grab Evander Kane or trade for Evander Kane. Do you think with this deployment that he currently has, can he match his like 30 plus goal, 70 plus point pace from last year? Or is it a situation where if you were one of the lucky slash smart people to snag him out of free agency, would you maybe now looking to try to sell for a huge return before the wheels fall off? Because this is a guy who, you know, had to have his contract bought out for a reason. So anything could happen.
Well, I mean, I think both of these things can be true. I think, yes, he can be a guy who scores at a 30 goal pace, 70 plus point pace over the season. Because I mean, he was a really good player on the ice, was very productive in San Jose with a lesser supporting cast. So I don't doubt that if you say, okay, Evander Kane, you're playing on Connor McDavid's wing, that the numbers can be there. But is it worth seeing what you can get in trade for him? Because, you know, there is an element of risk with Evander Kane that if things go off the rails, they could go off the rails pretty quickly and pretty hard, right? That if, you know, if all of a sudden, 3 weeks from now or a month from now, there are charges against Evander Kane, well, you know, there's a risk that you know, you're going to be taken. And I mean, look, that's a risk that the Edmonton Oilers are taking by making this signing in the first place. But there's, you know, some desperation on the Oilers' part, some desperation on Kane's part. So they sort of, I think they end up in a bit of a marriage of convenience here, is that Kane needs to rehabilitate his image fairly dramatically. And the Oilers offer that opportunity, right? That if they say, look, you're going to play with Connor McDavid, chance to put up some numbers. And I don't know that he's you know, going to be in Edmonton beyond this year. But I know that Edmonton's also not, you know, they have to look at what's happening this year and try and make the playoffs. So I do think that, yes, Evander Kane, like if he's available to pick up, which you know, in fewer leagues as the minutes go by, then yes, by all means, you should. If you do have him, though, I'd explore seeing what you could get in trade, because I just feel there's an underlying risk that goes with him based on, I guess, the entirety of his career for the most part, is that there's always something that kind of lurks around the corner with Evander.
Yeah, I mean, on one hand, like all due respect to the Oilers, like, yeah, they're taking on a bit of a risk. I think I'd be taking on more of a risk if I were to trade one of my star players for Evander Kane.
Oh, yeah.
But, right? Yeah, it's going to be really interesting. I'm going to bring up a player in our second headline that I'll ask you if you'd prefer that player or Evander Kane. But first, I wanted to stick with the Oilers. Just in general, like, what do you think of the Oilers' outlook for the rest of the season? Like, they had this really weird start to the year. Like, I mean, well, a great start, right? They were amazing. Yeah. Then what was weird was that it completely fell apart. But now this win against Montreal was their fourth in a row. So do you think we're back to the Oilers being like the dominant team that we saw at the start? Or I know they still like maybe need a goalie. Like we've been hearing news that Mike Smith might be ready to come back soon, but who knows, like if he's like similar to his self from last year and the start of this year. So what's your projection for the Oilers rest of the way now that they have Evander Kane?
Well, I when they got off to such a great start, I was like, well, they're probably not this good. And then they've gone through that long stretch where they, you know, were losing a bunch, and well, they're probably not that bad. And so I suppose the real Edmonton Oilers are probably somewhere in between. And I think they're a playoff team, which that seems like you're damning them with faint praise, that this team that has Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl. And I'm like, I think they probably should be a playoff team. That's kind of where I sit on that. And that's, you know, but if you said to me, okay, well, you've got this team, you've added Evander Kane, he's not going to get in any trouble for you, and do something about the goaltending, well, then, you know, I'd feel pretty comfortable with the Oilers as a playoff team. And so I think they're on that path. They do need to fix the goaltending in some way. And I would have a hard time depending on it to be Mike Smith. I mean, I think he papered over a lot of the Oilers' troubles last year. He had this kind of unexpectedly great season, and then they kind of got trapped in that they didn't make any changes in goal coming into this year. And then, you know, Mike Smith, because he's 39 years old or 40 years old, that, you know, those guys get hurt, and it's tough to kind of pin your hopes on him, especially when your hopes are, like, you know, the expectation here should be like that you're contending for Stanley Cups, not hoping to eke into the playoffs. And to pin that on Mike Smith at his age is, you know, that's not a great plan for success. And so anyway, I think the Oilers should be, you know, they should be a playoff team by the end of the year. But I also think that kind of in that process that they're going to have to change their goaltending in some way.
Right, yeah. So it'll be interesting to see if they make a move at the deadline. Aaron Dell was waived by Buffalo. I guess he's available
if you need an enforcer.
So yeah, I guess sticking with the Oilers. So now with Kane in the picture, like I said, and by the way, Ryan Nugent-Hopkins returned this past week. I feel like no one's talking about the return of RNH because Kane's taking all the headlines. Yeah. But yeah, they've shaken up a lot of the lineup. Like I said, so Yamamoto was on the top line with McDavid and Kane in this game on Saturday. Draisaitl with Puljujärvi and Warren Fogle. And by the way, Warren Fogle, 2 assists in that game. So if he sticks with Draisaitl and you're in a super deep league, just a name I'll throw out there. And then yeah, Ryan Nugent-Hopkins was centering Zach Hyman and Zach Cassian. So the Zachs and Ryan line. So yeah, I wanted to get your take on Hyman. He seems to be the biggest casualty of all of this, being relegated to essentially like line three power play to deployment, though I mean, to be fair, like it's line three but with Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, so not the absolute worst place. And to make things kind of more interesting, like Hyman actually had a really good game on Saturday. He had 3 points, like 2 goals and an assist. Of course, those 2 goals were on 2 shots, so obviously not the most sustainable thing, but like at this point, those 3 points brought him to 24 points in 34 games on the year, so it's a 58 point pace. Do you think that's like a reasonable clip to expect for the rest of the year, or do you think his numbers to start dropping if he's, you know, not going to be getting the plum deployment that he had for most of the way that got him to this 58 point pace?
Yeah. I think my expectation is that he'll probably stay in that range. I mean, maybe not quite 58, maybe it drops a little bit, because I guess my thought is that when you spread out your talent, the way the Oilers have with those three lines, that's the way a lot of teams like to do it in the playoffs, especially, right? Because you kind of run pairs. And so it's like, okay, we got a pair of Hyman and Ryan Nugent-Hopkins and whoever you put on the other wing. Well, it ends up being Zach Cassian right now. Well, we've got Leon Draisaitl and Puljujärvi, whoever goes on the other. Okay, so it's Warren Fogle goes on. But I feel like those guys are very interchangeable, right? Like if Warren Fogle is not playing well for a couple of games, well, Zach Hyman can move up the lineup pretty easily. And frankly, if Evander Kane is, you know, if he's not keeping up with McDavid, well, they could very easily make changes. You know, I think, you know, part of the lure to get Kane is, yes, we're going to give you a chance with McDavid. It's not a promise that he gets to stay there, you know, all season, no matter what. And so I think in Hyman's case, he's always going to have some upward mobility in that lineup that, you know, if everything is going great and all those lines are scoring for the Oilers, then fine. He stays on the third line and that's it. But, you know, given what we've seen from kind of that cast of characters on the wings, I think it's pretty reasonable to expect that there will be some changes as time goes on. Like if Kailu Yamamoto plays great the rest of the season, well, that's fantastic, but boy, that's kind of coming out of nowhere at this point. Like I think, you know, anytime you play somebody on McDavid's wing, you say, okay, well, that makes the player interesting, but you know, Kailu Yamamoto has been, you know, kind of scuffling along for a while. So I think some of those guys who are in good spots, you know, or were against Montreal, that's not necessarily going to prevent Zach Hyman from getting his minutes, right? Like given the investment the Oilers put into Hyman, right? Like I don't think that they're trying to, you know, diminish Zach Hyman in any way. I think this was sort of a, let's try and balance out these lines and see what happens. But if they run into any issues, I think Zach Hyman is a guy who's, you know, quite ready to move up if need be.
Right. Yeah. So that's very good advice there. People shouldn't be like overreacting and panicking because of these lines.
Well, when I saw those lines, I was going to make some smart ass remark on Twitter and say something like, wow, pretty expensive third line left winger there with with Zach Hyman. And then he goes out and gets a couple of goals. And I'm like, yeah, just better that I didn't even bother.
Yeah, well, I guess the thing is, like, probably a lot of people might be thinking, oh, it went so well, why wouldn't they stick with those lines? But again, it was against Montreal. Let's see how they do against a team that's not at the basement of the league. Man, we probably should move on from the Oilers. I do, though, just want to also get your take really quickly on Evan Bouchard, because he kept his hot run going in that game versus the Habs with an assist. That brought him to 4 points in his last four games. Tyson Barrie is day-to-day. He's probably going to return maybe after the All-Star break. Like, what do you expect is going to happen here? Like, if people have Tyson Barrie in their leagues right now, they have him stashed on IR. Some people have been asking, though, if they don't have that many IR spots, like, is he a safe drop, or do you think he takes Bouchard's spot back? And obviously this is something that you can't predict, but if you have a hunch about Bouchard and Barry's value for the rest of the way.
Well, I really like Bouchard, even when he was not playing much, say last season, because he could generate shots, like a lot of them. And, you know, probably to the point that it's more valuable for fantasy than it even is, you know, for real hockey. And so if he ends up, you know, I mean, his ice time has really gone up this year. And if he ends up kind of sticking on power play one, then yes, by all means, I'm kind of really happy to be on Evan Bouchard. But to me, I think you know, he has an opportunity with Barrie out. I don't think we're in a situation where, you know, Tyson Barrie is automatically the guy who comes back to take power play one. You know, that if Bouchard is playing well and the power play is producing, that maybe he has a chance to kind of carve out that role and hold off Barrie. But I mean, I think that's really get dependent on production, you know, that if the power play, you know, stumbles, well, guess what? We're going to bring back the veteran guy who's been quarterbacking a power play forever. Like, I think that's sort of where it is, but the opportunities here for Bouchard, you know, while Barry's out to make them think about it. And you know, that's a better situation than he was in before.
Yeah, for sure. So you're kind of saying, like, at least now Bouchard has the opportunity. Now it's kind of like with the goaltending, right? It was like Koskinen and Skinner, mm-hmm. like whoever played better was going to be the one that was going to get the next game. It's not like anyone is an incumbent at this point. That's interesting.
Yeah.
All right, so moving on from Edmonton now. So Ryan Nugent-Hopkins wasn't the only big star to return from injury last week. I'd like to go to Vegas now to discuss the second fantasy hockey headline of the week, in my opinion at least, Max Pacioretty's early return from his wrist injury on Thursday. Pacioretty was reunited with Stone and Stevenson on Thursday versus LA, and then Stevenson went on the COVID protocol, so Nolan Patrick took over as the center of that line. So far, though, the Pacioretty return has been pretty underwhelming. In his two games, he hasn't put up a point. He's only managed three shots total over the 4-1 loss to Florida and then the 3-2 win over Tampa. I assume it's like just too early to be concerned that Pacioretty isn't the same since the surgery. I just know that, like, I'm in a close matchup this week and I was super excited to bring Pacioretty out of my IR, and I think I would have rather just kept him in IR in hindsight and kept the guy who I dropped, because this has been nothing so far.
Yeah, and that's, you know, when it's just a couple of games, it's tough. But like before he got hurt, Pacioretty was massively productive this year, right? I mean, his shots per game is like 4.4.
Well, that's what surprised me about this, like, so few shots in these two games. But I wonder if it's just like healing still or something.
Doesn't fit with the way things were going before that. And now maybe some of this is that, you know, in the very short term, having Nolan Patrick as your center is probably not a, you know, an ideal situation. I mean, we've seen what they do with Chandler Stevenson. And I think, you know, that there's kind of credit has kind of gradually gone to Chandler Stevenson, you know, as there was all that talk about trading for Jack Eichel. Mm-hmm. You know, people started to kind of look at Jack Eichel and move in there, and he'll play with Pacioretty and Stone. And that very well, you know, is probably going to happen. But you started to look at it and go, well, Chandler Stevenson scored quite a bit playing with those guys too, right? And you know, maybe we had this, you know, the picture of him being a fourth liner in Washington is one thing, but he's sort of proven that he's a legit contributor. And so, I mean, now some of that is like Pacioretty and Stone can drag production out of a lot of players. But I think, you know, Stevenson has kind of elevated his production, but kind of the expectation, because even when Stone's missed time or when Pacioretty missed time, he still put up points. So And so I think, yeah, in the short term with Nolan Patrick as a center, that might be something that for the next, you know, however long that is, that might not be my favorite situation for Max Pacioretty. But if we're looking, you know, rest of the season, whatever, I think, you know, he's in a good spot that if he gets Chandler Stephenson back or they put Jack Eichel in there, well, that line could be one of the best in hockey. So I'd be, and given how well Pacioretty was playing earlier, I'd be pretty excited about what he should do the rest of the way.
All right, so here's my brilliant idea. I think you'll tell me if it's a brilliant idea. What if you have Evander Kane right now? Everyone is losing their minds over Evander Kane. The people who have Pacioretty, like myself, maybe are like, ugh, that was underwhelming, you know, that return. Should the Evander Kane managers right now be making a trade offer for Max Pacioretty?
Well, yes, I think you should. I mean, that's worth finding out. Because I trust Pacioretty's production. Now, that comes with, you know, Pacioretty is older and has run into injury problems. So, you know, there is some risk here. It's not right. As though you're getting 100% sure thing Max Pacioretty for super risky Evander Kane. I think, you know, it's a little closer than that. But given, you know, how well Pacioretty played early in the season, how consistent he has been throughout his career, basically, I would feel comfortable risking that. I mean, and really whether you're willing to deal Kane, I think probably depends on where you are standings wise. Like if you're comfortable where you are, you know, and you don't need to take a risk, well then sure, Max Pacioretty probably seems a little bit more safe and secure. If you need some variance in the outcome and you need somebody to exceed expectations, you know, maybe more than you think is possible, then, you know, Evander Kane with Connor McDavid might be the, you know, the risk worth taking. So in a vacuum, I prefer Pacioretty, but I think it probably depends on your situation.
Right. Yeah. But that is a good point that you make, that Pacioretty is not without risk himself. He's already been injured twice this year. Who knows what could go wrong next. And while we're here, I wanted to get your thoughts on a couple more cold streaks here in Vegas. So first of all, Jonathan Marchessault had a slow start to the year, but starting on October 27th, I just arbitrarily picked that date, but he's been from that date, he was money. He had 29 points over a stretch of 30 games, but this past week has seen him fall back to that beginning of season form. He's pointless in his last four games with only 10 shots in that span, which is way below the 3.4 shots per game. I don't know if it's just been a bad week. Maybe that's all it is. No one's shooting on Vegas all of a sudden. But Marchessault has been lining up with his best buds, Carlson and Smith lately, as well as on the second power play with those guys, along with Petrangelo and Haig. Is this just the kind of thing where Marchessault like kind of has to be a 60 to 65-ish point player and the universe will like never let him be anything more? Like maybe he sold his soul to have that superstar caliber first season with Vegas. And then after that, it's like, no, if you're ever doing well, you have to have a cold streak to get back to the 60-ish point pace. Like, or do you think is this just like a blip and now would be a great time to like, you know, grab Marchessault if he was dropped or like try to buy low?
Well, yeah, like when they had that that amazing first season in Vegas, he had 75 points. His on-ice shooting percentage was like 10.6%, which high. Like, that's,
well, yeah, wasn't William Carlson just like scoring on every shot?
I mean,
he had
William Carlson scoring 43 goals that year. So that's kind of something that helps juice your numbers, right? And now this year, Marchessault's on-ice shooting percentage 6.8%, which is actually quite low, right? And so, you know, so the real Jonathan Marchessault probably falls somewhere in between there, you know, around 9% maybe. And so if I'm, you know, looking at Marchessault, I probably expect that percentage goes up in the second half of the season. Now, it's not guaranteed to go up, but, you know, playing the probabilities, he's probably due to get a few more assists than he has so far. And so, I mean, I think that 75 is probably that could very well end up being his high watermark for his career. But, you know, if he ends up being a guy who scores 60 to 65 points, that's still a pretty valuable player, especially when he's effectively a second line winger, given that they have Max Pacioretty on the first line left wing there. So I think, you know, that might be just where he settles in there with Vegas, but that's still a pretty valuable player because he generates a bunch of shots. There have been times his hit rate isn't great this year, but it has in previous years. He's kind of pushed up close to 100 hits. So there have been times where you know, his fantasy value is a little bit higher than it is now. But if you could buy low on him in a trade, I'd take a look at it because of that on-ice shooting percentage.
Okay, yeah, that's great then. If he's going to get in on more of those shots more than we're going to go in the net. and then I guess we had another question from patron Joel. Wanted me to ask you about one of Marchessault's second power play companions in Alex Pietrangelo, who's also been pointless over his last handful of games. Much like Marchessault, Pietrangelo started the season cold, then went on a great run. He had 26 points in 31 games, but now he's on a recent five-game pointless drought. So Joel mentioned that he's noticed that Theodore seems to be taking the majority of the top power play time. Maybe Pietrangelo is transitioning into more of a defensive role. Like, should we be worried that the big offensive numbers from Pietrangelo from this long stretch earlier on was like not realistic, and in the second half it's going to be more the Theodore show?
Well, it probably does depend on how they choose to deploy their power play, but I mean, to me, it always made more sense for Shea Theodore to be their top power play defenseman. I think maybe you know, when you sign Alex Pietrangelo to this massive free agent deal, that there may have been some expectation that, okay, look, we're paying him this much money. Yes, he's going to quarterback our power play. But I think the Vegas power play has, you know, consistently been better when Theodore's the one running it, and you know, not by leaps and bounds better. But I think if you were to kind of objectively look at who generates better results back there, I think it's Theodore. And so, you know, my expectation would be that Theodore should run their first power play unit. You know, and you know, as fantasy managers, we're at the mercy of coaches sometimes on these with these decisions, is that, you know, you can sit there and think, well, Shea Theodore should be the guy, but if coaching staff continues to roll out Alex Pietrangelo, what do you do about it? Nothing. You kind of have to deal with it until they come around. And now, you know, I don't think Pietrangelo is, you know, all his offense is suddenly going to go away. But if you're asking me who should run the Vegas power play, it probably should be Theodore. And so I would probably be a little bit more optimistic about Theodore moving forward, and a little bit pessimistic, I guess, about Pietrangelo.
Right, that makes sense. I guess the thing is, it used to be that Vegas would run more like two even power plays. So yeah, even if Theodore was on like the quote-unquote top power play, Pietrangelo would still get like, you know, 45% of the time, or however it would work out. Yeah. So we'll see. Maybe once everyone's healthy, when Eichel comes back, they definitely have the star power to run two even power plays if they want to do that. But again, we're kind of at the mercy of the coaches to see what they're going to do. I would definitely preach for people to maybe try to get Pietrangelo if he's dropped. Like, I mean, the nice thing with him is he gets those peripherals, right? So even if he doesn't score, he'll give you those peripherals, and you know, he was slow before and he heated up. He obviously has those offensive capabilities.
Well, and you know, he's always going to get minutes, right? Like, it's not like he's suddenly going to be playing 18 minutes tonight. Like, he's always going to be, you know, 24 minutes a game. And any defenseman who can handle the puck a little bit and plays that much has a chance to put up some numbers for you.
Mm-hmm. Also, I think it's just telling that, like, I have like three kind of cold streak guys here on Vegas. That probably is just to tell that it's been a weird week, and like maybe now's a good time to take advantage of people who are panicking and now going to the All-Star break. It's going to seem like it's been forever. Like, oh, when's the last time Alex Pietrangelo got a point? It's been like a month. So it might be a good time to maybe, like, you know, get people who are panicking. All right. So for my third fantasy hockey headline of the week, I wanted to go to Vegas's recent famous trade partner in Buffalo. That was the deal for Jack Eichel, of course. And in Buffalo, though, the news I wanted to give was, first of all, that for a while it was looking like they might not have any goalies. They're all six of their goalies were either injured or suspended, but Craig Anderson all of a sudden emerged from the rubble to return from his upper body injury, and he not only returned, he shone in his return. He stood on his head, stopping 27 of 28 in the 3-1 win over the Coyotes on Saturday. The Sabres are playing again today, and another player has returned in Dustin Tokarski. We're only in the first period right now. He's already let in a goal to Gabriel Landeskog, which is especially frustrating to me because my opponent in the cupful, John, has Landeskog, and it's been bothering me. Scott, I have Rantanen, and John has Landeskog. Why is it that he's getting so many more points than me? I have the player that I spent more on in the auction draft.
You should have the advantage there, you would think. Yes.
Infuriating.
That is one of the most lopsided games in the NHL season right now. That Buffalo depleted lineup playing their second game in as many nights, going against Colorado, which has kind of been a juggernaut.
That's true.
It's as lopsided as any game I think I've seen this year.
So maybe we should be impressed with Buffalo that with halfway through the first, it's only 1-0 Colorado. Mm-hmm. Way to go. But anyway, yeah, speaking of Craig Anderson, that game on Saturday was his seventh start of the season, and that win brings him to a 5-2 9-2 record and a 927 save percentage on the year. So small sample size, yes, but, you know, growing slowly and like now coming back from injury to come back right away and have a good game. And like, sure, some people are on the COVID protocol at the moment, but Anderson's is returning to a Sabres team that is maybe, in my opinion, tell me if you disagree, it seems to be like one of the deepest Sabres teams we've seen in a while now. It's making me start to wonder if maybe like having their goalie isn't as bleak a prospect as it may sound. Like, I'm looking at the players, you know, they have that top line of Thompson, Tuck, and Skinner has been buzzing lately. Casey Mittelstadt just returned. You know, Cousins, like, you know, is a solid piece there. Kyle Okposo's been having this resurgence season. Peyton Krebs, who also came back with Tuck in that trade, he's coming off a week where he had two multi-point games out of three going into today, including one goal and one assist versus Arizona yesterday. So obviously the D, that's the problem, right? The D is filled with people that basically no one has heard of. Like, good luck, the listeners, quiz yourselves to try to name six defensemen on the Sabres, especially on Saturday when Dahlin wasn't there. But anyway, that's what Craig Anderson is for. You don't need defense when you have Craig Anderson, right? So what do you think? Is this like a potential high-value goalie that no one knows about yet? Or has my whole crazy setup here just been an opportunity for you to drop an epic hammer on all this misguided Buffalo enthusiasm?
Well, no epic hammer drop, because I have low-key optimism here about the Sabres, and for the reasons you're stating, right? Like, I'm looking at that forward group, and I'm sitting here, I mean, the Sabres have been just downright terrible for the past few years, and you're looking at that forward group and kind of go, huh, there's something there that, you know, and they've got prospects like Jack Quinn, you know, he's hurt right now, but came up and he was having a good start in the American Hockey League, and JJ Paterka. And so you can kind of envision, if you take the core of the forwards that we just talked about, and you add Quinn and Paterka, like, by next season, the Buffalo Sabres could have a competent forward group. Now, yes, you probably still want to solidify the defense and, you know, hope that you have a better answer in goal than what they went with this season. I mean, maybe Devon Levy gets a shot there. But it, like, kind of long term, I can, you know, see a light at the end of the tunnel, I guess, for the Sabres. And now, you know, maybe that's into the future. But I think kind of for the second half of this year, it would be reasonable to think that the Buffalo Sabres aren't just going to, you know, roll over and get crushed. Like, I think, you know, given how much of that has been going on there, that, you know, they're going to be inclined that you've got a bunch of these young pieces in place. Let's try and teach them how to be competitive and to win and, you know, play it hard down the stretch, basically. And so if Craig Anderson can stay healthy behind that, he might have some value. Now, you know, he's a 40-year-old who's played, what is he? Has he started 9 games in the last 2 years? Like, not a lot, right? And so, like, he's had a really good career. But if I'm picking him up for fantasy purposes, I'm not expecting that Craig Anderson is definitely going to stay healthy and play a starter's role to the rest of the way, because, you know, that's just not where he is in his career at this point. And, you know, if you need help in, on the waiver wire for goaltending, Craig Anderson still might be worth picking up, because the opportunity can be there. As long as he stays healthy, you know, there's a chance that they'll be okay. But I think, you know, even if you pick up Anderson, you're going to want to pick your spots with when you play him, right? Like, if he was going tonight in Colorado, I'd be sitting out Craig Anderson. That's a tough situation. And so, you know, there'll probably be some games like that for the Sabres, but, you know, I think the fact that Craig Anderson is even playing in a regular role this year, given, you know, last year he played like 4 games for Washington or something. And the fact that he's, I guess, the best option that the Sabres have in goal. Like, even if you took all the players who are on COVID protocols and injured and all that, and you put them all out there, Craig Anderson, I think, would be their first choice to play.
Yeah, maybe like Anderson and Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen.
And Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen would, you know, that, and I suppose when Luukkonen is healthy, then he's the one, because he's their future, right? And if you're building with all these young players, you may as well kind of get the young goaltender into it. But so in any case, I would say, sure, by all means, add Craig Anderson, but I don't think that he's necessarily a guy you can count on
For sure, yeah.
I wouldn't be trading away goaltenders so that I could add Craig Anderson, basically.
Yeah, maybe he's the kind of guy that, like, if he's available and then he's announced for the next game, stream him in. And if he has another good game, maybe hold on. Don't, like, drop him for the next streaming goal. Even maybe hold until something falls apart. Yeah, and you're giving me lots of reason for optimism. So when people in Dynasty Leagues, I think Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen, if he's available, maybe now would be a great time to grab him while he's injured and then see what happens.
Yeah, I think Buffalo... You know, as a side note here, I think Buffalo is doing some really smart things. I mean, I happen to know some of the guys that they've hired to be in their analytics team, and they're really smart people.
Oh, nice.
And so the fact that they have this young core of talent there kind of already, I would expect them to kind of make some smart moves in the offseason so that they're a more competitive team next year.
Yeah, I'll bet already a lot of people who maybe thought that they didn't get a good return on the Eichel trade, like after seeing what Alex Tuch has been doing, are already starting to change their mind a little bit. And Peyton Krebs, right? They're both doing really well. That's not even the pick. Okay, so I guess actually one question more about the Sabres then, like going back to the present here. If you could have one Sabres forward on your fantasy roster. Oh, by the way, side question. You play fantasy, I assume, right?
Oh, yeah.
I remember you used to be in a league with Brian Kaw, my co-host, like back in the day. How are you doing in fantasy this year? Like, how many leagues are you in? Just to get a sense of what you're up to.
I'm not in as many. I think I'm in three leagues this year.
Okay.
I mean, I kind of consider my main league. It's just an experts league that we've been in for quite a while. What am I in? I think I'm in fourth out of 12 right now in that league. Nice. I've got a good goaltending tandem. I've got Shestorkin and Campbell. So that has worked out well for me. But it's probably the complaints I have about my team are probably not all that original, that you have so many guys who miss time. And it's just, when I look at the amount of games missed for my roster, sometimes it can be just... aggravating, but nevertheless, I'm still competitive at the midway point. So we'll see if I can close the gap in the second half. But anyway, so who do I want off the Buffalo Sabres of all their players?
All right, no. So I want to make it a little more difficult on you. Let's say the top line isn't available. You can't have Tuck, available. Thompson, or Skinner, but everyone else, and you can't have Dahlin, and you can't have Craig Anderson. Okay, so a forward that's not on the top line. Who would your pick be for the rest of the season?
You know what? I think I'm going to say Casey Mittelstadt. And I mean, he's done nothing this year, but he's been hurt for the whole time. The only reason I'm taking him is because coming into the year, I kind of had him as a deep sleeper type because he finished last year pretty strong. And that was a real turning point, I thought, for him, because, you know, his early years with the Sabres were, you know, fairly awful for a guy who was such a high pick. And you know, he became a real test case for the eye test, where scouts were telling you how incredibly talented Casey Mittelstadt was, and then people who would look at his numbers and his NHL equivalencies at the University of Minnesota, and you're like, I'm not sure that he's going to have this instant impact, and he did, right? And it's taken some time, but it looked like last year down the stretch when he was getting a legitimate opportunity to play that, you know, there might be something there, that he could be a good part of the supporting cast. And so then the fact that he got hurt early this season kind of, you know, put that on pause. But I think, you know, the Sabres they're in a position where they're motivated to take some of these young guys and give them reps and give them an opportunity. And so, I think Mittelstadt will fit into that group of guys who's going to get a shot to play down the stretch.
Interesting. Yeah, I guess the lines today aren't really going to be too useful for us because Tage Thompson ended up not dressing. I'm seeing that Mittelstadt has been playing with Tuck and Peyton Krebs, and then we've had Okposo with... I guess Krebs and Okposo would have been two other options, but yeah, Mittelstadt's definitely an interesting option and probably available to everyone listening. So there you go. It's a deep cut there from Scott Cullen. If you're saying it, you probably want to at least give him a try. So I've still got, like I said, some hot streaks and then some questions actually from the patrons of Keeping Carlson. There's a lot coming. We're going to get to it in just a sec. You're listening to Keeping Carlson. All right, we are back. This is Elon Dubrovsky with Scott freaking Cullen. And I thought for the next segment of the show, I'm going to go through the top five surprising hot streaks to me going on right now. And I'm going to ask you, are these guys for real? Okay, so the number one WTF hot streak for me is over in Florida. I got to ask you about Mason Marchment. He has caught fire this past week. He's put up two goals and one assist in the 5-3 win over Winnipeg on Tuesday. He scored again in the 4-1 win over Vegas on Thursday, then popped another goal on Annapolis on Saturday in the 5-4 win over the Sharks. Man, by the way, side note, Florida is a very good team. They're winning all these games. So that's 6 points in these last three games for Mason Marchment. That brings him to 17 points in 20 games on the season. And so it's not only just this run. He's been having a really good year. And of course, this is even more impressive because he's doing all this from the third line and essentially no power play time at all on the first or second unit. Though, again, kind of like when we were talking about Zach Hyman, like this isn't a regular third line. Like he's been playing with Sam Reinhardt and Anton Lundell. So both fantastic players that would probably be top sixers on most other teams. But again, Florida is just amazing. I'm wearing a hat right now, actually. But yeah, Mason Marchment, only 2% rostered on Yahoo. Is this for real? And also, do you know who Mason... Did you even make a projection for Mason Marchment going into the season?
That's a good question. Boy, I don't remember if I did. I should have looked up...
I could check that while you answer about him.
To see. So first off, I don't think he's going to continue at a 17 points in 20 games kind of pace. But... There is some, you know, legit appeal to Mason Marchment. He's in his early time with Florida, the Leafs traded him to Florida. They got Dennis Malgin, who never, I don't think he ever played for the Leafs. Stayed in Europe, and that's, for a Toronto team that every once in a while likes to complain about, we don't have this, big bruiser to play on their lower lines. Well, Mason Marchment has, he's been that guy. He's a big physical winger. And so when he went to Florida, he'd play the fourth line and he would bang bodies. And every once in a while, there's an injury or something, he'd get moved up. I mean, I remember a couple of years ago, there was there was a stretch where, so I guess it would have been last season. It was Carter Verhaeghe and Barkov and Mason Marchment because, there was an injury on the right wing. And okay, so Marchment gets an opportunity. He's there for a few games and then shuffles back down. And I always thought that when you're setting up your fourth line as an NHL team, you want to have these players who have that upward mobility that, maybe they're not set to, make the jump from fourth line to first line as a full timer. But if you need somebody to do it for a few weeks, that they're capable, and the fact that they would give Marchment that opportunity kind of made me think that they have higher hopes for him than just a fourth line grinder, and the fact that they can put him in a spot on the third line where he's got good skilled line mates, I think this is something that he can kind of build on for moving forward and for the rest of this season. But having said all that, I don't know that I expect, 17 points in 20 games. You're looking at about almost a 70 point pace in an NHL season. And I don't think that's where he's, realistically going to end up. But, is it worth taking him, say you're in a deeper league and you want a guy who might be able to get you some points, but also will bang bodies and give you some hits? He can do that. He's got 13 hits in those past three games. You add that to the offense and there's a little something there.
Yeah. For sure.
So, I don't remember if I did a projection for him, but if I did, I'm sure it wasn't very optimistic.
So maybe it's probably better this way. You didn't do a projection for him, so then you don't have to say that you were wrong about him.
Yeah.
You had one here. I'm seeing the lowest ranked Panther that you projected is Noel Achari. You're probably right. You projected 22 points in 67 games.
That's rough that I put Noel Achari ahead of Mason Marchment.
Well, I don't know. I guess two ways to look at it, right? But it's hard. Yeah. That's why these are hard hot streaks to project. And I don't think anyone out there was projecting that Mason Marchment was going to do this.
I didn't see that a lot. That's for sure.
But yeah, it's an interesting streak. And like you say, like it's not the kind of thing you can expect, like consistent offense. But if you need a streamer in a game, the good thing about taking someone like him is like Florida scores so many goals. Oh. So if they're going to have a 6-goal game, he might be able to just give you an assist. We're not expecting like Sam Reinhardt to not do anything at even strength. And so if he's playing with Reinhardt, then there's always that chance. Yeah. Next up, I've got a pair of guys. I'm going to combine them that Ben and Lewis talked about on the latest Short Shifts podcast. They're Patrick Kane's latest and greatest line one and power play one line mates in Dylan Strome and Brandon Hagel. So Strome had 3 goals and an assist versus Detroit in the 8-5 win on Wednesday and then followed that up with 2 assists in the 6-4 loss to the Avs on Friday. Hagel had a goal and an assist and 4 shots in the Detroit game, then 2 goals on 6 shots in the Colorado game. I won't go over Patrick Kane's numbers, but they were fantastic and nice for anyone. I actually have Patrick Kane in one league. I traded for him and I kind of don't even want to tell you the price. I'm not really happy with the trade right now, but I'm happy now that he had a big week. So do you think these guys, Strome and Hagel, will be able to hold on to these roles for a while? Or is this like an Edmonton situation where we shouldn't be paying attention to the line combos because it could change like any second? Because if they do stick with Patrick Kane on the top line and the top power play, it's hard to imagine that they can't continue to contribute and provide value.
Yeah. And I think that's the case, basically, is that, look, as long as they play with Patrick Kane, sure, there probably some numbers will follow. Thing is, I mean, knowing how little the Blackhawks seem to think of Dylan Strome, you know, he's kind of been on the trade block there all year. And now I've seen, you know, pieces being written recently about how, no, you can't trade Dylan Strome. We're finally getting this production out of him. But, you know, I think there's the... if I had to, you know, make a wager whether Dylan Strome finishes the year with the Blackhawks, I'm not sure that I would, you know, I'm not sure I would feel really comfortable that he's definitely there for the rest of the year. He might be, but I think there's, you know, there's still some risk that even with this hot streak, he may not be kind of the long-term plan there. Now, having said that, I think he has pretty decent upside as a scorer that might give him a little bit more value than Hagel. And so, you know, if you're looking for grabbing guys off waivers, sure, you take Dylan Strome as long as he's playing with Patrick Kane and they move him down the lineup, then you drop him. That's kind of about how that would go, I think. And in the case of Hagel, I don't know if he's going to score enough to really, you know, have huge appeal, but it'd be something that I'd keep an eye on for him. Like, I think this is, you know, he's really carved out a pretty nice NHL career here early on. Establishing that he's you know, a legit kind of top nine forward. I don't know that I feel comfortable with Brandon Hagel as a first line winger. Sure. You know, as we're talking about, you know, sometimes guys are getting opportunities where they don't necessarily fit with the rest of the line. And I'm not sure Hagel is a guy who I think is a legit top liner, but you know, while he's given that opportunity, maybe you stream him in and see how it goes.
Yeah, well, hey, I mean, people who listen know I'm like a sucker for shots on goal. So I see those like 10 shots in Hagel's last couple of games. And yeah, it's like, okay, that combined with the deployment, definitely worth a shot. But yeah, of course, the big question, like you said, is like, how long will this last? And obviously, things have changed around so much in Chicago. But hey, yeah, it's interesting because Jonathan Toews wasn't on that top power play in the last game. So maybe it's just them finally deciding that they want to try some different.
I don't think Toews played last game.
Oh, it's because he wasn't playing.
So I think that might have been the you know, the reason that they just went, okay, fine, Dylan Strome, you're playing.
All right, fair. Do you have any hopes for Jonathan Toews turnaround, or is that just something
I lost? I have him on one of my teams, so there's wow, the hope of, all right, I you know, I took a flyer on him relatively late, and you know, I guess we're seeing a little bit more out of him, but you know, not enough to be terribly excited about it.
Yeah, fair. Okay, so I want to go to Minnesota next. So these are like higher caliber guys. I don't want to do only like 2% rostered fantasy here. So these are like surprising hot streaks just because, you know, better than I was expecting. And I'm talking about this line. Like, obviously the first line of Zuccarello and Kaprizov, like they continue to roll. Like, at this point, I'm not surprised. But the second line, I guess if you want to call it that, or maybe this is the third line, but the line with Kevin Fiala and Matt Boldy has like been huge. It's been amazing ever since Boldy entered the picture. Like, Fiala going into today, Minnesota's playing right now against the Islanders, but going into today, Fiala was on a 10-game point streak, 13 points over that span, and that's like not even, he was bumped from the top power play. People who saw Boldy come in would have been like, oh no, like Fiala's already having this like cold streak, now he's bumped from the top power play, I think I'm ready to be over this guy. And I'm seeing right now Boldy scored a second period goal assisted by Victor Rask and Kevin Fiala. So there you go, the hot streak goes to 11 games for Kevin Fiala. Then looking at Boldy, he had 7 points in 8 games going into today. He's got a goal and assist today. So we're talking point per game.
So 9 points in 9 games now.
Fantastic. And this game's not even over yet. Who even knows what he's going to do? So
9 points in 8 2/3 games, or 8 1/3.
Yeah, he's above a point per game at this exact moment in time. And like I said, he's on the top power play. He's clearly clicking with Fiala on this line. So I guess starting with Boldy, am I correct to say, tell me if this is like too spicy of a thing to say, but like, seems to me like he has similar fantasy value to guys like Lucas Raymond and Trevor Zegras at this point. Like, there's a lot of people probably who are regretting not having jumped on those two rookies like earlier in the season when they had the chance. Like, oh, I can't believe I could have had Lucas Raymond. I didn't grab him. It's like, right now, Matt Boldy, at least at the time that I prepared the show earlier today, only 7% rostered on Yahoo. So that means if you're listening, you have a chance to get, basically, in my opinion, Lucas Raymond or Trevor Zegras type in Boldy. Are you with me on that? That it's like we're talking the same caliber of guy?
Yes. I'm stunned that he's available in as many leagues as he is. When he got called up initially, I think he came up with Marco Rossi at the same time. I wrote something on McKean's about it because one of the things about Boldy is once he turned pro and he played in the American Hockey League last season, And the production was there last year, like point production was there, generating a bunch of shots. And I think coming into this season, I was relatively high on Boldy. And then he broke his ankle or something just before the season started. And so, you know, this guy who I would have, you know, put among the higher scoring rookies like Raymond and Zegras. In fact, I'm sure I expected Zegras to, I'm pretty sure he was my choice to be the highest scoring rookie this year. I didn't have Raymond anywhere close to that. But Boldy was one of my choices to be a relatively high scorer among rookies. And so the fact that he broke his ankle, I was like, oh, well, that, you know, opportunity missed. But the fact that he's come up to the National Hockey League and basically hasn't missed a beat. Like when he went to the American Hockey League after breaking his ankle, was scoring a point a game there, comes up to the NHL, is scoring, as we say, you know, a point a game ish at this point, and he generates shots. And like, I'm, you know, very, very bullish, I guess, on Matt Boldy. So it stuns me that he's available in as many leagues as he is. And so, yeah, anybody who's out there and you're kind of looking for someone on the waiver wire, grabbing somebody who has, you know, has been this productive right off the start of his NHL career is he's worth a look.
Yeah, sounds like a no-brainer. So let's even call this a pause the pod moment. Anyone who's listening, like, stop listening.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Get Boldy, then come back and continue on with the show. You're right, it is crazy. I actually grabbed him in a league just this morning, and I'm very happy I did, and I'm having a game right now, so I hope this will continue. So it sounds like you think it will as well. Oh, here's actually an interesting question in the chat here. Kevin C is asking, what do you think long-term for those people in the Dynasty Leagues? Because I remember when you were talking about how like Boldy and Rossi both got called up. Mm-hmm. In that moment, everyone was like losing their minds over Rossi. Like the first line combinations that got published had Rossi on the top power play, not Boldy. And I think everyone was like, you know, dropping whoever they needed to grab Rossi. And Boldy sort of was like low-key under the radar. Now Rossi's like not with the team and Boldy's doing so well. So right now, obviously for this year, no question that you want Boldy because he's the one actually playing.
Yes.
But like, let's say if you're in a Dynasty League, who do you expect to be the more productive guy long-term?
I think Rossi still has a chance to be more productive. Now, you know, if he ends up being slightly more productive as a center, Boldy giving you that production as a left winger probably has still more fantasy appeal. But I remember looking it up, you know, as they first got called up, one of the things that impressed me too, is that Rossi was generating a bunch of shots. He was about three shots per game in the American Hockey League and scoring better than a point per game at the time. And so, I haven't checked and seen what Rossi has done since he got sent back down. But you know, I would expect that he's still a kind of a big part of the long-term plans for the Wild. I mean, given the way they've sort of hamstrung themselves on the salary cap for the next few years, they're going to need guys on entry-level deals who can come in and play. And so I think, you know, there's a pretty good chance that Rossi, you know, whether he, I wouldn't be surprised if he gets still a chance to play this year, but at the very least by next year, I would expect him to be a very central part of their offense. And, you know, if he's maybe their second line center or something, I think that's a possibility. But I guess part of the challenge is with the Wild is you have to, you know, they're not prepared to just give up on Victor Rask, I guess. You know,
they waived him at one point.
They did. And at that point, I kind of thought, oh, well, this is the opportunity. But then, you know, he didn't go away. And so they kind of continue along with him. But I think, you know, we're going to get to a point where Marco Rossi is going to play and is going to be, I don't know how high his ceiling is. But you know, given how much he produced in the Ontario Hockey League, given how much he's produced in the American Hockey League, I would have to expect that he's going to get a chance to be a scoring center in the NHL when he gets here. So, but you know, if I have to pick between the two of them, I still might be leaning towards Boldy because if you get that value as a left winger, that tends to, you know, hold a little bit more.
Oh, I see.
A little bit more positional value in terms of fantasy, depending on your leagues, right? I mean, some leagues just count them all as forwards, and in which case, you might like Rossi, but if you actually divide between centers and wingers, I think Boldy's value on the wing might be a little bit more.
Also, like, call me like a dynasty league Luddite or something, but I, you know, to me there's also some value in just like Boldy's already proving that he can do this, so it's like, well, what if one day Marco Rossi could be point per game? Like, it's like Boldy's doing it already, so it's like, might as well take the guy who's doing it. That's the way I see it, but that's obviously simplifies things quite a bit. It's funny that you mentioned how Victor Rask, like, was, you know, sent down, but then now they can't get rid of him, now he's back. Remind me also of Matt Murray over in Ottawa, who I wanted to ask you about later. I'll just bring him up now since he came to my mind. Shams actually, one of our patrons, wanted me to ask you about Matt Murray. Like, he's not looking too bad since coming back from the minors, right? Like, all of a sudden, like, he was looking terrible, he was injured all the time, he got sent down, he waived, like, no one claimed him, of course, because he's got this crazy contract. But since he's come back, so he shut out the Sabres, stopping 32 on Tuesday, only 2 goals against on 29 shots in the 3-2 shootout loss to Carolina on Thursday. And to be fair, actually, Anton Forsberg played on Saturday, and he had himself a nice game, in another 2-1 loss. So are the Sens, like, all of a sudden just like a good defensive team now, and like that's why their goalies are doing well? Or is there a chance that Matt Murray is good again? Like, he's such an enigma, right? Because he obviously had this amazing start to his career, and he's just been so terrible recently. But every once in a while, I feel like he gives this taste of like a couple good games in a row, and like, I'm so tempted to like buy in, but then I just remember how like the last times I bought in, then like I stream him in, and then like a 6 goals against game, and then he goes on the IR right afterwards. So, like, what's your prediction for Matt Murray? Is there any chance that he can will salvage this contract with him, and he'll actually be a decent goalie?
Well, they won't salvage the contract.
Well, that was too high to ask.
That's a high bar. Yeah, that was a mistake the moment it was signed. But again, this is, you know, if you're looking on the waiver wire for goaltending help, and you know, he might be somebody that you could kind of, you roll the dice and say, okay, I'll take a shot here with Matt Murray. Now, the part of the problem is, and this I guess is the same deal with, you know, Craig Anderson, is that, you know, the team in front of him is not great. You know, there's some positive things there in Ottawa, but you know, it's not as though they're, you know, some lockdown defensive team that's going to make their goalie look good. And so, you know, any time that Murray starts, you know, you run the risk of, okay, well, maybe he plays a good game, or maybe it is a game where he gives up 6 goals and you know, really sewers you. So, you know, I'm pretty cautious on Matt Murray at this point. I guess kind of his last couple years in Pittsburgh and the way it started in Ottawa has sort of soured me on him altogether. Now, he's still of an age that he could get this back. You know, that I don't necessarily think that, you know, he has to be, you know, no longer a viable NHL goaltender. I think, you know, there's a path here to that getting better. But I'm not sure I, you know, have huge hopes for him to, you know, help your fantasy team down the stretch this year. You know, maybe you add him and stream him in very specific spots, but that's about as far as I can go with Matt Murray at the moment.
Right. Okay. Shams is saying in the chat that he just likes a goalie that's going to get a lot of games. But I mean, that's even a question, right? Like, Anton Forsberg is doing pretty well himself. Like, do you think, like, as long as Murray stays healthy, he's at least, at the very least, like, the starter? Or is that not even like such a thing?
Well, here's the thing is that when you've committed that much money to him,
right,
he should be, right? Is that, you know, that kind of gives you a leg up, I think. And like, I think Forsberg got an expiring deal. It wouldn't surprise me if the Senators, you know, consider finding, you know, a taker for him at the deadline.
Well, you got Oilers.
Yeah. Well, you got a bunch of teams who could use some kind of goaltending insurance. And, you know, it's not as though he's a huge difference maker, or that he's also not going to cost you a ton to get. But, you know, Matt Murray's not going anywhere. He's either in Ottawa or Belleville, it seems. So I think he's probably due to get a pretty decent amount of starts down the stretch. And if quantity of starts for your goaltender is important, then maybe that's enough to give him some fantasy appeal. But I'd be cautious.
Okay, yeah, definitely fair. And I guess let's stick in Ottawa. So I wanted to get to another one of these hot streaks, and I want to get your take on back to the very low percent rostered players. I got to ask you about Tyler Ennis, because with Drake Batherson out, Ennis has been lining up with Tkachuk and Stützle at both even strength and on the power play in the last game. Yeah. And Ennis is looking like his early 2010 Sabres self lately, or maybe even better. Like, he's taken full advantage of this newly acquired deployment. He has 5 points in his last 4 games, along with 19 shots over these last 4 games. Before that, though, he was doing nothing. And then I remember at the beginning of the year, he had a couple big games and then totally disappeared. So is this like you know, a situation like you're talking about with the Oilers, or like I think I brought up with Chicago, like the lines are going to change. Like, they're like, you know, don't rely on Tyler Ennis to stick with Tkachuk for like a long term stretch. Or do you think this might be the kind of thing with Batherson out that this could be cemented and Ennis could be more than just like a flavor of the week?
Well, before Josh Norris got hurt, I was actually really liking Stützle and Alex Formanton playing together, right? And so Formanton's another guy who's not rostered in a lot of places, who's been more productive lately. But you know, with Norris out and Batherson out, it's like Stützle and Ennis are getting that shot with Tkachuk. And really, again, this is, you know, when you're getting that opportunity to play on the first line, I think even on a team that isn't great, that should kind of put you in the fantasy discussion. Right. And, you know, I can't tell you that, oh yes, you should start dropping people and race to get Tyler Ennis, because they could change it tomorrow. But he's also a guy who has shown kind of in to varying degrees, that he can score. He did it, you know, previously in Ottawa. He's done it with Toronto, where he played in a very limited kind of fourth line role, but his, you know, his per minute kind of offense was solid. And so, you know, I don't think I mean, because if I'm Ottawa, my objective here isn't to make Tyler Ennis, you know, have him have a great second half. I would rather have young forwards who are going to be part of the future here be the ones who are getting that opportunity. And so a guy like Formanton, he might be someone that I would prefer more. But, you know, it might take some time for the Sens to kind of sort out how they're going to handle their lines, because, you know, as it stands, you know, today, the opportunity is there for Ennis. And so I'd kind of wait and see, I guess, how long that's going to last, because my inclination is the Senators should be looking to give some younger players that shot rather than, you know, a guy. I mean, Tyler Ennis is not long for the NHL beyond this season, I don't think. So,
yeah, well, when he got, I think, feel like this already happened where the Sens had him and he was doing well. Then they traded him at the trade deadline.
Yeah, I think they traded him to Edmonton, right?
Yeah. So like maybe they're just going to try to, you know, cue this up again.
Well, here, that's it, is that you can kind of pump the value for a little bit. And if he's scoring, you know, there might be teams who are willing to bring him in to have a little bit of depth scoring, because he won't cost a lot to acquire and he's not making a lot. So you can fit him under the salary cap. Like, there is some value to doing kind of these short term pump and dump things for NHL teams if you can get some value out of it.
Yeah, so I guess it's the kind of thing where, like, if you're in a limited moves league, don't add Tyler Ennis, because you don't know how long it'll last. But maybe go Formanton then if you're picking between the two. But maybe in the short term, take the guy playing with Tkachuk. I'd even strengthen on the power play. By the way, a note in the chat here, Patty is saying, I haven't verified this, but saying Casey Mittelstadt will not return to tonight's game. So this is a guy with injury history, and maybe he's ready to go. So I guess disregard Scott's answer.
Yeah, disregard my earlier recommendation of Casey Mittelstadt. Yeah.
Just to, obviously, we don't know the extent of the injury.
Yeah. Well, this season is, and just in general, is that because between COVID and just regular injuries, we go through so many players. Yeah. Right. Is that if you look at how many players have actually played in the league this year, it's an enormous number. I think we already passed what the league record was. Now, part of it was we have a 32nd team. But, you know, I think it was like 10 or 12 games ago that the NHL already set a record for the number of players to play in the league this season, because, you know, you take all these COVID absences and injuries on top of that and a 32nd team. And, you know, we're working our way through a lot of these depth charts, and, you know, guys like Casey Mittelstadt are doing their part to keep it up.
Yeah. Or the six goalies on that team that have played as well. Okay. So I want to go back to these hot streaks. I want to go to San Jose. This isn't a super hot streak, but I did want to bring up Jonathan Dahlin, who was cold for a while, but then had a couple games in a row with a goal. I see he had an assist today. So that's 3-game point streak. Though the thing I was kind of most excited about him was that he was playing with Timo Meier for those last couple of games. But it looks like today for San Jose's 2-1 loss to Carolina, he was back on a line with Logan Couture and Rudolf Spalsers, and was Barabanov with Meier and Hurdle. So it makes me less excited about Dahlin. Obviously, having a nice rookie season, like, don't get me wrong. Yeah. But, like, the reason why this actually disappoints me for the most part is that means he's playing with Logan Couture, like, which kind of feels like an anchor lately, because Logan Couture has totally disappeared, which is really frustrating, because he did this last year as well. He had a super hot start and then fell off the face of the earth. And again, this year, he was super productive, and it looks like around, like, 8 games ago, he stopped. Like, he has two assists in his last eight games now after today, taking two or three shots a game. Nothing going in, of course, but that's also not like an insane number of shots. So maybe you can say that he deserves like a bit more, maybe a goal or two over that span. But what do we do with Logan Couture now? Is it like at this point just drop him? Because I still am like a bit traumatized from last year. I had him in one of my leagues and I held him like way too long waiting for things to turn around. And it just like never happened. And eventually it was like, wow, I wasted a lot of opportunities to pick up free agents that could have done something. So where are you at with Couture right now?
Well, I mean, it probably depends what kind of quality is out there on your waiver wire, because
if Boldy is there, if Boldy is there,
if Matt Boldy's there, by all means jump in, right? But this goes to like opportunity is going to be there for Logan Couture, right? He's always going to get ice time in San Jose, and it's tough to go grabbing a guy off the waiver wire in place of a center who's going to play 18 plus minutes in the role that Logan Couture tends to play for the Sharks. And so like when you're talking to somebody like Dolan, I think essentially you want him to ride the coattails. And so if he ends up on Timo Meier's line, well, then you feel like, okay, that's a pretty good spot to be, because Timo Meier's been great. And if you can kind of, you know, reap some value from somebody playing alongside him, great. But that, again, this goes to the conversation we've sort of had several times here, is that, you know, that value is very tenuous. And that if Jonathan Dolan, you know, they move him to play with Couture and that line isn't going anywhere, well, then Jonathan Dolan doesn't have a ton of value, because he's not on his own. He's not going to drag that line into being something, right? And he's sort of still at the stage of his career, I think, where he is very dependent on who he's playing with, and kind of dependent on them to drive the offense, and he can just kind of contribute as part of it. And as you say, like, I mean, he might score 20 goals here as a rookie, and that's a pretty good rookie season, making the jump from the Allsvenskan in Sweden, like they're not even their top league. So all in all, I'd consider this a big success, what the Sharks have had from Dolan this year. But I would be kind of cautious about, you know, what kind of value it's going to offer for the second half of this season. I mean, I think some of this also depends on, like, if the Sharks are in it, you know, whatever in it is, that if they think they have a shot at the playoffs, you know, whether that means they add players. And if they do, well, then a guy like Jonathan Dolan might be a prime candidate to lose a spot in that top six.
Right. And then I guess on the other side, if they don't think they're in it, maybe they trade like a Tomas Hertl, and that opens then more opportunity. Right. Though then also then it's like, then you don't get to play with Tomas Hertl. So I guess it depends how that goes. So I feel like there's like kind of like Dolan is like in that second tier of rookies this year. Yeah. Like we talked about like Zegras, Raymond, like Boldy, obviously Moritz Seider, he's a defenseman. Like these are guys who are like leaders on their team, even as rookies. And then in the second tier, you've got guys like Dolan and also like a Michael Bunting, who probably also isn't someone who would drive a line all by himself. But man, did he have a game on Saturday. The Leafs had like all this past week, we saw these weird line combinations where they were running like Nylander, Tavares, and like Matthews, like all on different lines, you know. Like they were really trying to spread things out. Michael Bunting was going to play with Matthews and I guess Andre Kasha, but anyways, like midway through that game against Detroit, like Sheldon Keefe like scrapped that, went back to Matthews, Marner, and Bunting, and that worked out very well for Michael Bunting, who had a hat trick. So a huge game for him. If you were to consider, like, after that first tier of rookies that I mentioned, and now we're in the second tier, is Bunting the top guy, like ahead of someone like a Dolan? Like, it just seems like such a great spot for him. He's kind of run hot and cold all season, so I'm curious to get your take on like what you've seen from Bunting so far this season.
I really like Bunting. I mean, obviously because of the chance to play with Matthews and Marner, and now, I mean, I say that I would be fine with pretty much anybody that they rolled in there. Like if they said, all right, Andre Kasha, you're playing, okay, well, we'll give him a shot. But I think what we've seen from Bunting is that he's such a good complement to those two players. Like he does things that they don't in terms of like battling in the corner for pucks, going to the net and stirring up trouble. Like he does, I mean, his skill set hardly overlaps with Matthews and Marner in terms of what he's doing on the ice and what they do. But that entirely works, right? He's got the role that he can fulfill with them. And so when the Leafs were making those line changes during the week, you know, I just, I don't know why they're not kind of, I mean, maybe it's just some experimentation and, you know, we're in the middle of the season. You can, there's nothing to prevent you from going back to those combinations. But I think the Maple Leafs, for the most part, should be quite happy about rolling out Bunting with Matthews and Marner. And then for fantasy purposes, that makes Michael Bunting pretty useful, you know. And yes, you have a guy who's playing on a really good 5-on-5 line. He's been playing on the second power play unit all season, which, you know, there's some value to be had in that, you know, for a guy who kind of had no NHL career until halfway through last season. So I think, yeah, Bunting among the kind of second tier rookies, he's one of the guys who I would like, because just the opportunity is better than so many other guys.
Yeah, like Patty's actually mentioning in the chat here, Anton Lundell maybe is another guy who fits into that category, who he's been good. Lundell actually strikes me as someone who's probably could be like a first-tier rookie in a different situation. Like, it's just he's on the line in Florida.
If you weren't on this juggernaut Florida team where he might have an opportunity to play a little bit more. He's still having a very good rookie season, no doubt.
I wonder, like, what does a player prefer, do you think? Would you, if you're a rookie in the league, would you rather be like a Trevor Zegras, be like the star of your team, like right away, but not like a strong playoff contender? Or would you rather be like a Lundell who really, like, you know, doesn't get the fanfare? He's a third liner, but he's on a team that's going to likely go on a big run.
I think you'd prefer the Lundell spot because you'd always want your team to be, you know, to have a shot.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's like if your agent can spin it, right? It's like when they're negotiating a contract, it's like, hey, he helped you win a cup, as opposed to like maybe these many points.
But that's the kind of thing that sticks with you, you know, for your entire career, right? Is that if the Panthers, you know, if they go on a run this year and they win a Stanley Cup and Anton Lundell is playing a top nine role for them, then, you know, surely he will have chances to contribute in a really meaningful way in a big spotlight as a rookie. Like, if you go and win the cup, then that kind of sticks with you for the rest of, you know, your career, that, oh yeah, as a rookie, he played that well for us on our way to win a Stanley Cup. Now, you know, as great as the Panthers are, they're hardly a sure thing to win the cup. There are still some big hurdles to overcome to get there. But, you know, I think given the choice, you'd rather have a team that has a shot at the Stanley Cup all the time.
I need to get a player on the show at some point. It's like, ask them. I think I'd agree with you, though. I don't, knowing myself, I feel like I'd rather be the star, but maybe this just goes to my ego or something. To end the show, I just wanted to ask some questions that I got. I mentioned to the Keeping Carlson patron community that we had Scott Cullen coming, and I was like, if anyone has any questions, and of course, a bunch of really good ones poured in because people were really excited to have you here on the show. So I'll throw a couple of the really good ones at you. So Shams, who asked the previous questions here in the chat, and he's also the person, by the way, I don't know if you know Scott, we have a few really cool Twitter accounts that we've been running, Game Day Lines, where we retweet all of the line tweet combinations from beat writers.
Yes.
Shams has been helping me with that. Yeah, so we have a few ones like that. So good job, Shams. But anyways, okay, his question to you. Thoughts on Tyler Seguin? And it's actually, this question's already changed since I wrote it. So basically, this is the story with Tyler Seguin. Nothing all season. Then, like a couple weeks ago, he had this like run of three games where he had like three amazing games. And I believe like Robertson or Hintz or someone was injured. Like, I think Seguin was getting like a bit of an inflated role.
Yeah.
Then like everything went back to normal in Dallas, and Seguin, three quiet games once again. So then Chance was asking, was this just three-game point streak a blip, or is he worth a hold? Though I should point out that a small update is that Dallas is absolutely destroying the Boston Bruins today. It's currently 5-1 midway through the third. And Tyler Seguin has a goal and an assist for himself. So he's having himself a bit of a game. He scored an unassisted goal in the first. I see he assisted on a Jamie Benn goal in the second. Like, my general take, my general answer was going to be, like, if you threw to me, like, that it is a blip, and the Stars just seem to me like the type of team where they basically just want their first line to produce, and then everyone else just, like, try to keep, you know, pucks out of the net. But what do you think? Do you think now, maybe now that Seguin had this good game, this is your opportunity to try to sell him for something, or do you think that he could be for real? Because he used to be such a big star in the league and totally disappeared.
Yeah, well, I mean, the tough thing here for the Stars is that their best players of years gone by have really been worn down, right? Like, I think Seguin had surgery on both hips or something, and Jamie Benn's had multiple surgeries, and so I think when they roll out, you know, when they have Robertson and Hintz and Pavelski, well, wow, that's a great line, and they're really productive. And if the Stars are going to get production out of like lines two and three, it's almost like they need a time machine because Ben and Sagan and Radulov, none of those guys are what they used to be. And, you know, yes, it would be nice. And I think Sagan might be the one who of those three that I would look at and think, yeah, there's still a path to him getting back. Like he just had those surgeries in the off season. And so the fact that he's, you know, maybe he hasn't been in prime form this year shouldn't come as a total surprise. But, you know, I would basically be, I would tread cautiously here with him. Like if you found somebody better on the waiver wire, again, Matt Boldy, yes, I would be willing to drop Sagan and look elsewhere. But he's also the kind of guy that, you know, I'd consider, you know, in another situation, I might consider buying low on him and seeing whether or not the, you know, as he gets further away from surgery, that maybe his body starts to feel a little better and you have a chance that he can produce in the second half. But I'm pretty wary of the Stars, you know, the kind of the second tier guys there, because it seems like their bodies are really breaking down. And, you know, usually once that starts, it doesn't get much better.
Right. Yeah. So we could always be hopeful that, yeah, he'll all of a sudden just keep healing and get better. But I think games like this are going to be more of a rarity. We're like, yeah, probably. If he's available, you could stream him in. If he has a good schedule, maybe he'll give you a goal and assist in a game, but don't expect long-term production. Okay. So then Jacabs wanted me to ask you about Connor Hellebuck because he's been really bad for a while now. That's his quote, but I agree with that. I'm taking a look over his last six games. No wins, only one quality start, according to Frozen Tools. Yeah. He's had 5 goals against in each of his last 2 games versus Vancouver and Florida. Overall on the season, Hellebuck sits at a .909 save percentage. That's down from the .916 save percentage from last season, which was already a disappointment, and down from his Vezina winning .922 save percentage from the year before. So is this a case where like Connor Hellebuck is following a Matt Murray trajectory? No, I shouldn't say that. Like that's too crazy of a question, right? But like
it's
how
a little harsh.
Yeah, that's too harsh. But like is this like a huge buy low opportunity? Like he's going to bounce back, or do you think that maybe, because I remember back when Hellebuck was doing so well, everyone was saying how like he's really bailing out this team. I kind of like what you said about Mike Smith earlier, right? Like it was like the team has bad defense and Hellebuck was making them look better and obviously putting up these great numbers. But obviously at the end of the day, if you're a goalie for a team that has weak defense, there's only so long maybe you can last. And so, yeah, do you think this .909 save percentage is going to stick, or do you think he could have a bounce back in the second half?
I mean, I think he can finish better than .909, but and the Jets made moves to improve that defense in the offseason. But I don't know that it's improved enough. I looked on Natural Stat Trick, and there are 35 goalies that have played 1,000 overall minutes, right, so far this season, and only 7 of them have a higher rate of expected goals against than Hellebuck. So he's still facing a pretty high quality of shots against, which, you know, given that the offseason was supposed to be, well, the Jets have really solidified this defense in front of him, I don't know that has borne itself out quite as much as you would hope. And so I think Hellebuck in the year that he won the Vezina, and even last year, he had played so much better than the defense in front of him that in some ways you get spoiled. And every once in a while, you know, sometimes really great goaltenders, it's like they just get overwhelmed by it all. Like John Gibson's had that, I would say, in the past few years in Anaheim. This year is different. Like they're a much more competitive team, and Gibson seems to be playing all right. But I think when you've kind of been the guy and you've carried the team for a while, that there are times where, you know, your performance starts to slip a little bit and the team's not helping you out at all. And I think that's sort of where we are on Hellebuck. I mean, I would try a buy low on him if you can find somebody who's looking at that .909 save percentage and isn't too thrilled about it, because I don't think that it would get dramatically worse. Like even if the rest of the season doesn't go great for the Jets, I don't imagine that all of a sudden he has an .890 save percentage or something in that range, right? Like, so, and then there's still the chance that, well, if you really get Connor Hellebuck playing at his best, well, then it could be pretty good. And now the other kind of, you know, non-numbers aspect to this is that Hellebuck does seem like in terms of there were a few interviews and stuff where it seems like he's one of the guys who is not loving the COVID protocols and such that are going around the NHL. And I think there are some cases where, and particularly with goalies, I remember hearing about Carter Hart last year, that guys were saying that it was really hard on him. And then, I mean, we saw what kind of season he had. It was disastrous. Right. And so maybe that's something that, you know, could kind of be an underlying cause here, that, that Hellebuyck isn't quite at his very best, because, you know, the way the pandemic has gone for, you know, it affects people differently. And just based on how some of his interviews went, you could tell Hellebuyck wasn't terribly thrilled about, you know, the number of lockdowns and all those things. And some guys can handle it better than others. And I think, you know, maybe in the case of Hellebuyck, maybe that's something that's, you know, kind of bothering him on the day to day.
I see. Yes. Maybe it's gotten in his head a little bit. I guess it's such a mental game for a goalie. It's interesting. Like, I feel like I'm of two minds, because on one hand, I totally agree with you. Like, yeah, if you could buy low right now, like get him for a decent price, then why not? He's still the starter. Like, he's clearly a star in the league. Yeah. Like, you think things would get better. I almost wonder, though, on the flip side, like, probably you still could get a really good haul for him, since, like, you know, he is the starter. Yeah. And like, he has this great track record. So part of me wonders if maybe it's a good time to like sell low, if that's a thing. Like, well, like, just obviously depends what you could get, but like, my policy has always kind of been, and like sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, like my policy has been never to like pay a lot for a goalie, just because they're so random. And like, you know, you draft Connor Hellebuyck in the second round and he's been a lot worse for you than like a Jack Campbell, who you could have gotten, you know, in like the sixth round or something. So I almost wonder, like, if you could get a big haul for him, like, you know, a goalie who's decent. Like, I don't know, like, I'm trying to think of an example of a goalie off the top of my head. Maybe, like, Minnesota, like, Cam Talbot. Well, maybe, yeah. There's some tough situations there, because, like, Talbot has a backup. That's maybe challenging. But you know what I mean? Like, get a goalie who, you know, you could depend on somewhat, but also get, like, a huge skater upgrade. Maybe now's the time to cut bait. Though I do agree with you that there's definitely a chance that he could do better. It's just, it's so hard to predict with goalies, so it's, like, it's hard to even give advice.
Well, but we were talking about that, Dynasty League that I'm in with experts, early in Hellebuck's career. It was a league where we had four keepers, and I had Hellebuyck. I got him, you know, kind of early, when he came out of college, and had some initial success. And I'm feeling like, oh, I've got this guy who's going to be a, you know, lockdown goaltender for me for a long time. And then, like, I want to say his kind of second full season, so third season in the league, he struggled. He had like a 907 save percentage, right, or something. I'm like, wow, I can't keep that guy. Right, 907 save percentage. I got to let him go. Well, then for the next 5 years, he's been, you know, one of the very best. And this is such as the nature of goaltenders, is that you can, you know, you can think that you know who the good ones are, and all it takes is one season for you to kind of have to, oh, hold on, I'm not sure. And, you know, and so even the very best of them, you know, Hellebuyck's had some season, you know, one or two seasons where he's been off. Carey Price has had seasons where it hasn't been so good. Like, it, almost every goaltender, you know, as good as they are, is going to run into some seasons where the numbers just aren't what you expect. And, you know, it's, I you know, the saying goes that goalies are voodoo, and I don't even know if that does it quite justice.
Okay, here's my insanity wolf idea that I'm not actually recommending, but if you have Connor Hellebuyck, you sell him for just the best skater, like get like Gensel, like, I don't know, get like a really good skater, then you grab Craig Anderson out of free agency to fill his spot, okay, and you'll be fine.
Well, maybe Craig Anderson, Dustin Tokarski, and Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen. You need to get all the Sabres possibilities.
Yeah, Sash Luukkonen and IR, and then Graham Anderson. Okay, so I guess to end the show, I guess since we're on Winnipeg, we might as well, you brought up how they tried to shore up the defense, and one of those things they did was bringing in Nate Schmidt. Mm-hmm. And we've been talking recently about the struggles of Neil Pionk, and Brian has him in the couple, the Keeping Carlson Ultimate Patriot Fantasy League, and he was maybe wishfully saying that he still believes that Neil Pionk can turn things around. Hey, he's on the top power play in Winnipeg, like, you know, like maybe it's just a cold stretch, but actually things have kind of changed in the last couple of games. It looks like it's been Nate Schmidt running the top power play, and Neil Pionk has been bumped a lot, like that happened last year, right? Like Josh Morrissey ran the top power play for a bit. Mm-hmm. So clearly it's not like Neil Pionk's spot with like an iron grip. And actually Schmidt is on a decent run. He scored in the last game. He's got two points in his last three. What's the panic level, first of all, on Neil Pionk? And then severally, like, what do you think about Nate Schmidt if he's available for people to grab at this point?
I wouldn't get into a huge panic over it, but because I think when you have Neil Pionk, you're not expecting that, oh, he has this ironclad grip on the top power play unit. You know, I think when you have him, you're like, well, it's nice when he's getting those minutes, but you realize that it's not like a birthright kind of thing for him, but the production has to be there. And if they decide to go another way, then that's life. And so, you know, since this is still relatively recent, I'd hang on to Pionk and, you know, see if he can kind of gain it back, because I mean, he's, you know, aside from recent struggles, he's been really good since going to Winnipeg. I think far better than most people expected, myself included, when he came over in that trade from the Rangers. So, and then for Nate Schmidt, I don't mind Schmidt in kind of a deep league, but he always seems to be, there's like a ceiling on what kind of production you get out of him. And so I wouldn't expect that he's going to be the first power play quarterback for the rest of the year or anything like that. Like, to me, given all we've seen throughout his career, that's probably not a role that he's going to hold for the rest of the season. So, you know, I still don't mind him. Like I said, in deeper leagues, he's, you know, modestly productive, half decent player, but I would kind of, I guess, keep my eyes open on what's happening with the Jets and how they decide to handle it.
Right. So it's another name to throw out there if you need D. Maybe take a look if Schmidt's available. Maybe just to throw out some comparables. I feel like he's maybe like a Justin Falk type that I've seen drop in some of my leagues. Maybe even like a Noah Dobson, who maybe has the potential to like be on the top power play on the Islanders, but, you know, generally doesn't produce that much aside from that one stretch a month or so ago where he went hot. Okay, Scott, this is like, first of all, the time has flown by. This has been such a pleasure and honor to have you back on Keeping Carlson. I really appreciate it. I'm sure the listeners really enjoyed this show, but I think I've taken up enough of your time here. You're used to doing those like 5-minute, 10-minute podcasts that you used to do on the other network. Before you go, do you want to just like let people know like where they can find all of your great work, anything that they should be checking out?
Well, sure. You can always find me on Twitter at @ByScottCullen. That's kind of the easiest spot to track me down. But I've been writing sports betting stuff for a company called sportsbookreview.com. And so and I cover lots of hockey there too. But we also, football is obviously a pretty big thing right now, and basketball. So kind of bouncing around sports there. But I also still doing fantasy hockey piece once a week for McKean's Hockey. And so kind of I haven't written on my Substack. I have a Scott Cullen Hockey at Substack, but I may have to dust it off to kind of add some fantasy content to it. I don't know. We'll see, but those are, you know, you check out those spots, you'll find me.
Great. Yeah. Well, I guess they're definitely, yeah. So the Sports Book Review and McKean's, of course. Look, McKean's, by the way, has their own projections I know at the start of the year. Did you contribute to those?
No.
Or, okay. So those are separate projections. Those are not Scott Cullen projections. Okay.
I mean, I did, as part of their preview magazine, I wrote a bunch of team like player profiles for a good number of them, but I think they have somebody else who does their, the actual point projections for them. And I was, you know, I'm fine with kind of keeping those things separate, and that way I can put out my own projections at the start of the year. So, you know, that is always, you know, kind of no matter where I end up writing and so on, I'm still happy to do the projections when the time comes.
Well, that's awesome. It's like Christmas for me, like the day that you're projecting. It's always like, it's in two stages, right? First, you have those projections of just the points.
Yes.
Like, yeah, that's fine. I'm kind of curious to see. But like, I need the full projections. I can put them in my spreadsheets to get my rankings for my specific league.
Yeah.
That's the really exciting day. So yeah, obviously we'll have to wait until October. Patty actually wrote in the chat here, like, can you ask him to make the projections sooner next year?
I may be able to. We'll see. As we talked about off air, my schedule during the pandemic has not been what I had hoped would be. So if we ever got to a point where the world was kind of normal, I'd be thrilled to maybe get things out a little bit earlier.
Well, I guess it's a double-edged sword also, because like, there's always those developments in training camp that may lead you to wish you waited a little bit. I guess it's the internet. You could always change things. So yeah, thanks again for coming on. If you ever want to dust off the podcasting, you're always welcome here on Keeping Carlson. We love having you. But yeah, thanks everyone for listening to the show. So again, you can follow Scott at @ByScottCullen. Follow us at Keeping Carlson. If you want to continue becoming a patron of Keeping Carlson, keepingcarlson.com/patron. You'll find all the information for that in our show notes. But yeah, with that, I think that it's time to bid everyone adieu. So Scott, good luck in your fantasy leagues for the rest of the year.
Awesome.
Once again, thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me. It was great.